really out of the concession to the weakness of human nature. And the reason for that is because, according to the Church's theology, in the Eastern Church, marriage is not something which is bound by the time scale of this world. Marriage is something which is both eschatological and eternal. Marriage, according to, I think it's Gregory of Nyssa, although you have to be careful with this because not all fathers agree on this. Marriage, according to St. Gregory of Nyssa, is the only sacrament which predates the fall. Adam and Eve in paradise, according to Gregory of Nyssa, have a full and complete married union, which includes a sexual union. Now, some fathers find that very difficult to contemplate, and they postulate a kind of asexual regeneration of the species in paradise before the fall, if that were to take place. But what we have with marriage is something which both predates the fall and which carries on in to heaven, not in a physical sense, but in an eternal sense. When Christ says that in the kingdom they are neither marry or are given in marriage, but are like the angels, this has no impact on marriages which are contracted in this world. We enter, married people, enter into the kingdom of God, mystically united with each other, still in the continuing iconic parallel with the relationship between Christ and the Church. So the Church's practice of blessing a second marriage is really as a concession to the fact that in this life we do not conform to the ideal. According to the canon law of the Church, a priest who is widowed may not remarry. And according to the canon law of the Church, a priest's wife who is widowed also may not remarry. This is rather harsh, actually, but this is the situation that we live with. The reason for this is actually that, in a sense, the ordination of the priest supersedes the marriage and completes and is completed by the marriage. The real completeness of the married priest's pastoral ministry in the parish comes in the presence of a good matushka. And I have to say that, speaking personally, I would not be able to function as a priest without my wife. I think that she forms the role. This is not just my wife, but it's the, is she here? Good night. You remember those words in the book of, Proverbs where the writer describes what the ideal woman is like, who is a thing of great beauty, but also a thing of immense practicality and intelligence. Well, I think this is what both the ideal matushka and, in fact, my own matushka is like. She must be both the conscience and the arms and the hands and the compassion of the parish priest when all of these things are not working, when his own versions of these are not working properly. The matushka is the only person who can tell the priest very often, shut up. The matushka is the one who can quietly say to him, you should not have said that to somebody, you must go and apologize immediately. So this is, in a sense, the ministry of the priest who is married is completed by the is completed by the ministry of the matushki. Of course, the priest who wishes to remarry is free to do so, but he is not able to practice his priesthood. We have in Oxford, my great friend, the priest of the Greek Orthodox parish in Oxford, a priest whose wife died when they were young people. She was diagnosed with cancer and diagnosed 6 months after the diagnosis, leaving him alone with two children aged 9 and 6. Which he brought up with help from a devoted parishioner by himself. You can see that his situation was somewhat desperate, and many people said to him, Oh, I think it's a terribly cruel and callous thing that the church doesn't allow people like you to remarry and to continue their priestly ministry. And privately he said to me on more than one occasion, they simply don't understand. Why on earth would I want to marry again when I'm still married to my wife? And my priesthood as I live it out now, she is still a part of. And of course now he's an older man, and he's somebody who has lived his life longer as a widower than he was as a married man. One observation about this question has to do with our understanding of vocation to priesthood as well. It's true that vocation to priesthood comes in different ways. Sometimes the vocation is from the church community, the parish, who will recognize from within its midst somebody who can serve them, who will approach the bishop and say, Vladika, we have this man and we would like to present him to you for you to give your blessing to serve us as our priest. Sometimes the vocation will come from the bishop himself, who, according to his wisdom, his authority, and his gift of divine grace of oversight, will identify a particular person and say, I want you to serve the needs of the church. Sometimes the vocation will be an inner vocation from God to somebody who will feel that they have been chosen by God in spite of their own weakness and a brokenness to serve as a priest. Not everybody has this third vocation, I have to say, at least not in an explicit way. But for those of us, and I can speak as somebody who from the earliest childhood only ever felt called to be a priest, for those people in that situation, such a vocation must be confirmed by the calling of the church. It's no good to say, I feel a vocation to be a priest, therefore you must ordain me to the bishop, because the sense of God's personal calling has to be confirmed by the calling of the church, which is the body of Christ. And very often we have a notion, particularly amongst men in the Orthodox Church, that because they're men they have a right to be ordained. And therefore that the canon law of the church, if it doesn't suit their situation, needs to be changed. Sometimes having to exist and live by canon laws which are difficult, hard to take, perhaps even outdated and in need of change, can be for us a good lesson in humility and acceptance. As the Apostle Paul was saying, there is something very precious about accepting one's own situation in life and simply taking it on board as a place wherein we can work out our own salvation with the help of our Christ. I think we ought to finish there, because the children will be wanting a break and the leaders will be wanting a break from the children.
Спасибо, отец Степан, за замечательный ответ на своего рода такой, может быть, болезненный вопрос. Но все-таки чувствуется, что тема не до конца раскрыта, и давайте продолжим наши беседы на эту тему завтра после заключительной беседы. Спасибо большое.